Dear Ambassador, welcome to Moss and welcome to Bylab, and to everyone else, welcome to an evening focusing on American politics. Since this is the first time Mr. Ambassador is visiting Moss, I will take this opportunity to say a few words about our city. Moss was granted status as a commercial town in 1720, and in 2020 we will be celebrating our 300th anniversary. The combination of good infrastructure with the lake and the waterfall formed the basis for industrial activity and the foundation of Moss. From the late 1800s until the 1990s, Moss was a typical Norwegian industrial city. In recent years, several of our large industrial companies have unfortunately been closed down. This has affected families and small-scale business throughout the Moss area. As a city, we are currently facing major changes, some of which are very exciting. We have an ongoing plan for urban development with a progressive new approach. Some of our city planners are working from this open office downtown called Bylab. It is on the main street and it's open for the public. This increases the public interest in our city and it creates good dialogue between the municipality and the residents in the area of Moss. Because of our long industrial heritage, we possess a solid expertise, which is very useful building up new industry and make the city appealing for new inhabitants. In the future, we would like to develop a center for higher education in this area. Recently, Moss has made an effort to increase cultural activity. Moss is well known for its art galleries, particularly Gallery F15, which is located in a beautiful landscape at Jeløya. And in 2013, the whole of Norway and Moss celebrated the 150th anniversary of the birth of the famous painter Edvard Munch. Munch lived 3 years in Moss. Moss has also an exciting range of music, theatre and festivals to offer during the whole year. During my time as mayor, I had the pleasure to visit our sister city, Virginia Beach, and these kinds of visits helps us to get to know more about each other's history and culture and bringing us closer together. There are many similarities between the US and Norway, but there are also many differences. The organization of politics and campaigning is one of the differences. In Norway, we have many parties and our campaigning is more about issues than the candidates, I would say. It is interesting to follow the US election campaign, and most people here in Norway, I hope that Hillary Clinton will win at the end, not the bomb. The debates and the media stories are many, and it's probably the tabloids that reach us here in Norway. We are looking forward to learning a bit more about American politics and campaigning tonight. And again, I would wish Mr. Ambassador Samuel Heins welcome to us.
Mayor Pettersen, Ambassador Heins, Mr. Bosch, Mr. Larson, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the American College of Norway, I would like to say we are happy you were able to make it to this year's presidential debate. There have been note cards placed on the seat, and this is to write down any questions you could have, and there will be ACN students coming along to pick those up. If you have more than one question, feel free to get another note card. I am Bethany Larson, and I am currently a study abroad student at the American College of Norway from Mayville State University in North Dakota. I never thought when coming to study in Norway, I would be given such great opportunities and experiences as I have now. By being in Norway, I've been able to focus on my own personal biases of the election going on at home while experiencing it from a different perspective in a different country. It has enlightened my understanding of very important global affairs and it made me appreciate the relations the United States has with the beautiful country of Norway. I am very proud to introduce the United States Ambassador to Norway, who is from a neighboring state of Minnesota. Samuel Heins is a lawyer and human rights advocate who became U.S. Ambassador to Norway in March 2016, before he was nominated by President Obama to represent the United States in Norway. Ambassador Heins was partner in Heins, Mills, and Olson law firm in Minneapolis, where he served as lead counsel in several national security, fraud, and antitrust actions. He grew up in Rhode Island and Illinois, but has lived in Minnesota since attending college in that town, home to many of the 5 million Americans who claim Norwegian ancestry. Ambassador Heins has spent much of his life promoting human rights. In 1982, he founded the Minnesota Advocates for Human Rights. In 1985, he co-founded the Center for Victims of Torture, and these are issues he has worked with continuously since. As part of being Ambassador of Norway, Ambassador Heins is trying to travel as many parts of Norway as he can to address important issues of the transatlantic relationship. Ladies and gentlemen, help me welcome United States Ambassador to Norway, Samuel Heins.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here, Mr. Mayor, ladies and gentlemen, dear friends. As you know, the United States is a monarchy with a democratic parliamentary system. And that was a laugh line. I want to start with an anecdote, it's true as they come, about that goes to the relationship between the United States and the Kingdom of Norway. I came in early March, and 10 days later there was the annual meeting of the Chiefs of Mission back in Washington, so having just recovered from jet lag getting over here, I was able to go back to refresh my jet lag. And at the end of the first or second day of that meeting, the president invited over to the White House those of us who'd come back to Washington, who'd been appointed by him from the political world, which that was one. And we were all, you know, pretty thrilled to be there. It was a beautiful March evening. The South Lawn was magnificent. The Washington Monument was rising up in the illuminated in the distance of twilight. Planes were landing down the Potomac River, the National Airport. And the president came out and went around the group and greeted each of us in turn. When he came to me, he didn't say the usual, you know, "Hi Hans, how are you? What's going on? How are things in Norway?" He came up to me and he looked at me straight in the eye. And he said, "I wish I had to deal only with Norwegians." And then that was what he had to say to me. And whatever the outcome of the election, the relationship between Norway and the United States could not be stronger at very many levels, including the defense relationship, the alliance in NATO, and a whole array of other subject matter where the officials on both sides are very close friends, work together very closely. It truly is one of the great international friendships in the world today, and it's been my privilege to be part of it and to observe it up close and personally. That's been great fun. In that regard, I've been saying to audiences in Norway on the subject of NATO, that as far as this administration is concerned, which will take us through January 20th, I can speak with authority and say that the obligations of the United States under the NATO treaties are ironclad. They are treaty obligations. They will be honored. They're perceived by the United States as the foundations of peace and Europe whole, free, and at peace. and the intention is, and the legal obligation is to continue that, including Article 5. And I can also report, because that only gets you through January 20th, that we've had in Oslo in the last few months a number of congressional delegations that have included very high-level leadership Republicans, very conservative, and I'm not talking conservative as in Hoyra, I'm talking really conservative as in U.S. conservative. They have made the point, as they've come to Oslo, to tell me and to tell high officials in the Norwegian government that there is no question from the Republican side of the aisle, whatever may have been said in the course of this curious election season, that NATO is an ironclad obligation, that it is deemed such by Republicans, almost to a person, and that it can be relied upon. So I put that before you, and I think it's a serious point that should be made. I'm happy to make it. I'm told that there is interest in the electoral college system. Is that true? Do people want to hear about the electoral college? Let's have a show of hands. Electoral college is a possible topic. We had a debate in the car on this, and I said I thought it was not necessarily the most fascinating aspect of our presidential election. So I can get there, but what I really would like to do is take questions, because that'll be far more interesting than anything I can speak about in the first instance. One of the questions that's arisen as I've been in Norway since March about the election has been the question of whether or not there is a significant movement in the United States that is reflected by the views that have been stated by the Republican candidate. Does that, he's nominated as one of two of the two major parties as the candidate. What does that reflect? And I obviously don't have a definitive answer to that, but I think it's worth pointing out that numerically, in order to win the Republican nomination this year, Trump has attracted something on the order of 11 million votes in primaries, direct votes, and perhaps another million or so in caucus states, approximately the number that Hillary Clinton attracted. Obviously, there were 17 starting out, so his capacity to attract that number of votes and to do it consistently fed into his ultimate nomination. Early on when I arrived, various people, including the Prime Minister, to be frank, suggested to me that there was abroad in the world a sense of populism, distress, economic distress, that was evidenced by the Brexit vote, by the rise of populist, nativist movements in France and in Austria and in, you know, name the other countries where that's the case. And I, obviously she's a very skillful observer of things political. My own view is that that's not the case, that in order to be nominated in the United States requires something a little bit over 10% of the size of the electorate that went to the polls in 2012. 135 million votes or something of the sort 4 years ago. So what I see take from that is that Trumpism, whatever his views may be, does not reflect a widespread broad gauge shift in the American landscape or the perception of Americans about their democracy or the economy or their place in the world. Only my view, but I think that's relevant. The other the other aspect that I think is relevant is that Norwegian apprehension based on its experience in Norway with the parliamentary system, where you're going to have two major candidates, and obviously the one who does not necessarily get the most votes, as in the current prime minister, can wind up the prime minister. And if you have Trump on one side and Clinton on the other side, I think at least some Norwegians were sort of under the impression that perhaps one of those two was going to end up as president, and it wasn't necessarily clear. And obviously it's the case, as you know, that it's the winner of the Electoral College vote, whoever gets 270 Electoral College votes, prevails and becomes the president, and the loser is dead man gone, politically speaking. After the election 4 years ago, Mitt Romney had no political power. He's widely respected by many people, but he was plainly out of contention as a political force. And that is, of course, the system, which brings me to the Electoral College. My staff says, you know, you have to talk about the Electoral College. So I can tell you who to blame. So the Electoral College awards votes based on the number of representatives to Congress from each state. So each state has at least two senators, and then it has a number of congressmen or women, representatives, based on the population of the state. So the states with the smallest population have two senators and a representative get three votes. States with many more representatives get many more votes. And it does not exactly track the number of votes, popular votes, necessarily, as was the case in Bush versus Gore, in which Gore attracted more votes, but they just, at the end of the day, were not from the right states. So the way that this works is that the nominees currently can look at the map and know that some states are going to be Democratic. New York, Democrat. California, Democrat. And some states are going to be Republican. In a normal year, Indiana, Texas,
Georgia,
some of these are in play this year, but in any event. So the map gets divided up, and given what is presumed to be the result in those states, neither candidate gets to the magic 270. So candidate has to prevail in the so-called swing states, and those are traditionally Ohio, Florida, Virginia,
Pennsylvania
sometimes, Wisconsin sometimes. It depends on the year and the. So I seem to be confusing this more than making it clear. But at the end of the day, you win if you can prevail in the states that are the swing states. There's no point in a Democrat campaigning in New York or California because they're going to be in your column anyway. You have to focus all of your attention. And that process is underway. And the way in which you can have the popular vote not determine the president is by having such a heavy vote, for example, in highly democratic states that have a limited number of electoral college seats. You could suppose 90% of the voters in California turned out for the Democrat. There are only so many seats in California. I don't know off the top of my head what it is. Anybody else? It's a lot, but anyway. It doesn't translate exactly into the number of electoral college seats. So you can still win the electoral college with fewer than 50 plus one, 50% plus one of the popular vote. I tried. it's an odd system. I can talk a little bit about data analytics in the campaign. Maybe I'll do that and then I'll take questions. How are we doing, okay, on time?
Yeah, we're good on time.
Okay. Four years ago, the Obama campaign was very skillful in deploying data analytics. And I refer to the Obama campaign because at the time, before I taken a vow of silence, I was active in the Obama campaign. And my wife and I showed up in Chicago on election night, or election day, and we were asked to volunteer for a data analytics bit of work, which was to report to a hotel ballroom in Chicago with our iPads and our phones. And when we got there, we were assigned, we were plugged into the system and told to put into our iPads our own zip code so that the computer localized where we were from. So people with Minnesota accented speech would then get on the phone, and we were, as we, you know, put in our zip code, up popped a name, and with the name, a phone number, and the number of times that the person had been met at the door, or had signed a petition, or had given some indication that the person was an Obama voter, and their voting history, and a variety of other facts that were gleaned from public sources. And we dialed the number automatically, and said, I'm from the Obama campaign, you know, have you voted yet? Can we help you get to the polls? Can we do whatever? It was a very impressive system. The man who put it together was in Oslo a few months ago, and we went and had dinner, and he told me that what has now happened is light years beyond that. All of that takes place by way of get out the vote. Every contact at the door is recorded on the iPad that the volunteer is carrying and becomes part of the database. But even beyond that, the data analytics has become so refined that it's possible now to know when it is best to call particular demographic voters. Women with children are best called, you know, the 2 days before and the day of. Older white men are best called the day of. I'm making these up, but they're able to fine-tune it in such a way that by figuring out the kind of the demographic you're from, when it is most effective to call and make a pitch, and what the pitch should be. It's really pretty incredible. So we'll see what, if any, effect all of that has on the campaigns this year. So with that, I'm happy to try to respond to questions. I'm duty-bound to tell you that I'm an employee of the federal government, and therefore limited by the Hatch Act. I can't take partisan positions or make partisan arguments.
We'll go ahead and do this part of the question and answer. Just, you know, raise your hand. More of the partisan questions, obviously, we can hold off for until we have Republicans and Democrats abroad.
One of the statements of Mr. Trump is that the election is going to be rigged, and this is a rather dangerous statement, I believe. Can you comment on that?
Well, I can. I'm a lawyer, so I'll try to give you a view of what would be required to rig it. Each state runs its own system of vote counting. And in many of the states, it varies state by state, but in many of the states, the counties of which, for example, Minnesota, which is a state of about the size of Norway in terms of population, I think we have 72 counties, I think you're from Minnesota. I think that's about right. It's a lot of counties. So in order to rig the vote in Minnesota, you'd have to conspire with 72 county auditors and then to the Secretary of State. And then you'd have to replicate that across 49 other states in the District of Columbia. So whether or not that's practically feasible, I think, is a question you can answer for yourself. The president has said, and a number of other people on both sides of the aisle have said, that talk about not accepting the outcome as it's declared is extremely dangerous and not in keeping with the traditions of the United States. So I merely quote them.
Well, follow up. I think one of the problems was that, that during the election with Mr. Bush and Al Gore, and I think it was in Florida that there was some problems with the counting. This was a lot of fun on the internet anyway, about the counting of how you voted in Florida. And so the question is has the voting system been changed since then, or is it still a paper that you have to put holes in?
I don't know what the situation is in Florida, and it varies state by state. Some states have it all on computer, some states have you do a paper ballot and feed it into a machine. It varies by if you're voting in person or voting by absentee. It varies. Yeah. Sir?
This election seems, American election compared to Norwegian seems a little polarized, kind of. But this
election,
some of the two major parties, of course, things are focused on that. But this election in particular, it's really dividing the American population. For instance, when you hear people talk about a debate afterwards, some Republicans say that it's a clear win for Trump, and of course the other way. But is this is America as divided as we can get the impression of watching the debates and watching the comments on from, let's say, both sides of the aisle?
Well, I obviously don't know, and I don't have particular insight into it other than having been party to practical politics and the process of getting my own nomination to be ambassador to Norway through. So let me refer to that. That was held by right of one senator claimed the right to hold the nomination of the ambassador to Norway and the ambassador to Sweden without any publicly stated that there, he had no complaint against either of the nominees. He just wanted to make a point with the president on the various issues. And I believe that at the end of the day, that stalemate was overcome by responsible action by senators on both sides of the aisle. And it was not taken in front of the TV cameras. It was not discussed in front of TV cameras. It occurred. Because at the end of the day, they have to, you know, however vitriolic sometimes the statements are back and forth, to please the most stimulated voters at home, work does get done in Washington. So there's that reality. And I don't, my own feeling is that the divisions reflected this year don't reflect the United States as I know it. I mean, people, I have friends who are Republicans. And I, you know, and people who have very different political views, and I don't get a sense of, you know, a revolutionary dislocation of the United States, to the contrary. Yes, ma'am. So.
Yes, I would like to know, are there any Republicans there? Or are they all packed with it? Oh.
One.
I'm here.
It's not that I'm Republican, but I tend to see the side of Republicans also now. I used to live in the US for 20 years, and I worked with the Democrats all the time from Robert Kennedy until, you know, 20 years later. So I worked with the Democrats all the time, and when I got back to Norway, I changed parties. So I'm what you call Høyre now in Norway. And I tend to be a little more Republican. But I see the Norwegians, even the right in Norway, they're all Democrats, Hillary. And I think the Norwegians really don't understand very well the American politics, the primary, what it's all about, because Norwegians tend to look at it as a circus almost, because we think that we have the best system in the world. But I think the primaries is the most democratic system that there is. It takes a year, but it's very democratic. You know, here, it's the party that decides the candidates. And people are not really involved at all. Just a few that decides who's going to be on the ballot. But maybe I'm a little devil's advocate. I like to maybe see Trump do a little better in November.
So would we.
Yeah, I've got it. And and all these things, I watched last night CNN, and I thought Trump was very good at the Catholic had this gathering. I think it was in California or no?
You know, I can't wade in. I mean, it's obvious where I come from, but the particulars of last night or the night before, I can't speak to.
But it's not strange that every time they talk about America, Hillary won the debate, because all the newspapers are against Trump except newspapers and television channels except Fox News. But CNN is totally
one way Hillary. For sure.
And even Mrs. Obama
I really am reluctant to get into a political debate. You're going to have one. As soon as I leave.
I thought it was so one-sided democratic in the beginning, so that's why.
I'm sorry, that's the perception. Yes.
How do you think the growing rate of inequality in the U.S. is affecting democracy and systems that are mainly functioning on solidarity, like the public school system and Social Security?
I mean, it's a very good question, and I think it's the root of significant problems in the U.S. actually. I'm not sure that I'm the best person to speak to it. I know that I'm not, actually. You know, my job is to try to represent the president in the United States in Norway. But I think the premise of your question has great validity. I think pretty much everybody agrees. The question is what to do about it. Yes, sir.
I just want to ask you, what is your perception of Norway since you moved here? The climate?
climate, to food, to culture? How do you like it here? Make it a little easier for
you. Thank you.
Republic,
Well, actually, I love Norway, and as does my wife. And we were here as tourists a couple of times, fell in love with Norway before we arrived in March. We've had a great time. It's a wonderful international relationship. We're part of that. Up close and personal, the people we've met have been wonderful. The fish is great. we love the Lofoten Islands. We've been there twice with friends. In a short time we've been here, and I was unhappy to see that the New York Times features the Lofoten Islands and the surfing opportunities there on the front page, I think this week. That may induce a rush of surfers from New York to go to Lofoten and clog up the roads. But buying wetsuits. But, Norway's a great democracy, a great ally. Spectacularly beautiful. So I could go on and on. It's actually sort of a tough question to answer because on the one hand, I recognize that Norwegians are tremendously proud of their country and entitled to be. On the other hand, I have this perception that expressions of wild enthusiasm are sort of not usual in Norwegian culture. So if I say, Norge, our feet, within a couple of exclamation points, people gotta go. You're overplaying it, Heins. But that's how I feel. Yes, sir.
Yes, Mr. Ambassador. It's a political question that I think you can talk about. You've seen enough in the U.S., politically speaking, of how things are going and relationships and I think even in Norway, how do you compare and contrast the way things come together from a political stance and how folks are working from an American versus a Norwegian perspective from the political arena aspect of things? Comment?
Yeah, thank you. One of the things that's really been tremendously impressive for me and for Stacey too, my wife, who's both of us have been active in politics for 35, 40 years. Early on, we had a breakfast that assembled the youth leaders of, almost all the parties. And they sat around our breakfast table and had serious discussion about serious issues. They were well-informed, they were articulate, they all knew each other, they were all respectful to each other, and they had some vigorous debate. And it was really pretty wonderful. And as I look around and meet people in politics, mayors and people who are in the parliament, I look at their resumes and it's apparent that they started out as youth party members, many of them. And that's really a wonderful, democratic, wholesome approach, I think, to getting people into politics and to serving the communities by doing politics. So I've been tremendously impressed with that here in Norway. And there were, on campus, young Democrats, young Republicans, but it's not the same kind of thing. It's not a consistent, sort of maturation of people as political players. So I'm very impressed with that. Yes, sir.
You got Excellency. First of all, I welcome you in my city on behalf of my registration and Mr. Tage Pettersen. My question is this, that if Hillary Clinton wins the election, and she will 100% win the election, what will be the foreign policy? They will support ISIS, Islamic State, Iraq and Syria? What they will do against them. In Syria, you have another policy. In Iraq, you have another policy. So this is my question, sir.
That's my payback for the easy question. I
mean, it obviously requires a crystal ball, and I think a Secretary Clinton as president would, you know, would formulate a foreign policy that would not be identical to the foreign policy of President Obama, but it would be, I don't know. I just don't know. Yeah, I'm sorry.
I've been working with Americans for many years, and what I see is that it's very difficult to do business with the U.S., especially in the defense market, because of it's very protective, defense market in the U.S. So my question is, do you work to open up business relations between Norway and the U.S.?
You have something specific in mind?
Well, for instance, the F-35, the new frigates. All of these.
The F-35 has substantial components from a number of allied nations, isn't it?
Well, it's okay. Well, there are some. It's not substantial. It's there are some, but it's there are other. Other areas as well where the Americans are very protective, and it's especially in the defense market, and I think this is about buying American, so I was just curious if you have any initiative to try and improve the business relations between. Now I'm talking about business. Relations between Norway and the U.S.
Yeah, well, there are initiatives undertaken by the Commerce Department and undertaken by the embassy to try to advance trade, to try to advance foreign direct investment by Norwegian companies in the U.S. and to expand export of goods from Norway to the U.S. and from the U.S. to Norway. And there are cooperative relations on a number of levels. I led a trade delegation to Washington to a presidential initiative on this that had, I think we had 12, 15 representatives of Innovation Norway and a number of representatives of major industrial companies from Norway. I think it was deemed a success all around. And the access to U.S. markets, I think, is something that we hope to achieve. And with regard to particular markets, I can't comment. As a general matter, it's certainly the hope and the aspiration that we can trade freely back and forth. And I think it's, at least in some industries, we really do. Yeah. Yes.
Back to the electoral college system. You don't have to explain anything. But given the difficulties,
I already tried this one.
The complexities of the system, and I have two sons who are voting from abroad, and they're wondering, does my vote count because of the electoral college system? And what happened in the Bush Gore? Is there a talk or any discussion about changing the American system? It's pretty antiquated. And do people feel it works well, or is there any consideration about moving forward more with popular vote weighing in more?
Amending the Constitution is a very heavy lift, and I think given all the other things that people are concerned about, the impetus to do that is not there. It's conceivable, and I think how much their votes count sort of depends on where they're voting. Realistically, if they're voting in a swing state, it perhaps has more impact than if they're voting in a state that's solidly red or solidly blue. Yes.
The views on electoral college doesn't differ much between Republicans and Democrats. Do one prefer it or not?
I don't think so. I mean, I think it's has been suggested. It's an artifact embodied in our Constitution, and the Constitution is obviously a key document and one we revere. It's the basis of our democracy. So fiddling with it is not something we do lightly or frequently. Sir.
So we talk about the presidential elections and voting, electoral college, but doesn't it votes also impact local elections that maybe even have more impact than a presidential, like in California or some of those other states?
The House of Representatives?
House of Representatives or the Senate. Wouldn't their kids' votes make a difference in those?
Sure, elections? Absolutely. Yeah, depending on the particular race. The congressional race, in whatever locale they were voting in the Senate race, if there's a senator up in the Senate, in the state. Yeah, true. Good, sir.
Thank you. Mr. Master, there has been a lot of dirt coming up in the politics, and that's how politics is, and especially American politics. But candidate Trump has been speaking about Libya and emails that has been leaked in regards of Secretary Clinton. Do you think that that's going to drag her down on the polls?
Kind of a political question, and I don't know.
No.
So I've opted to look that way.
That's easy.
Time is moving along, and we are thankful that the ambassador is here. I'm Krista Lauerton. I'm the director of the American College of Norway, and Becky Norvang, who's approaching the corner here, is our student advisor. She is the one that planned all of this, but I am the one who gets to thank the ambassador for coming tonight. So we would have loved to give you a Norwegian wine, but I had a hard time finding it. We hope that you will enjoy this American wine. Thank you so much for your time.
Pursuant to federal regulations, I will now tender this to the embassy.
I also know that the mayor has to leave. He has another engagement, but I'd like to thank you as well. And the American wine might mean a little more.
thank you
so much for coming.
And good luck with the debate.
Thank you.
And I am a student at the American College of Norway. And I am, unlike Bethany, I'm Norwegian. And it is with a great honor that I stand in front of you today and get to introduce both Democrats and Republicans abroad. The reason why this is such a great honor is because of my time at ACN. My time at ACN will lead me to my degree in the United States, and I know that the presidential election will affect me and other students in some way, in several ways. From the Republicans abroad, we are lucky to say that we today have Rick Bosch. Rick Bosch is the vice chairman of Republicans Abroad Norway. He is an entrepreneur involved in business development and project management, currently working with U.S. Ferry, a joint American-Norwegian maritime transportation project to be located in the U.S. Rick is a permanent resident of Norway, residing in Oslo, but is originally from the state of Virginia in the U.S. From the Democrats abroad, we are excited to introduce Brad Larson. Brad Larson is the vice chairman of Democrats Abroad here in Norway. He has been in Norway for 33 years, and he is originally from Maryland in the United States. He runs his own company here in Norway called Wordflow. Before he moved to Norway, he worked 12 years in Washington and 8 years in contact with Capitol Hill. And we wanted to include something we see on the presidential debates on television. We wanted to include a coin toss to who goes first. Yes, so I have an American quarter here, so
wow.
I'm going to do the coin toss, hopefully.
They come between you?
Thank you.
Yeah, somebody's hit it.
So heads will be Democrats and tails will be Republican. That's fine. Yeah, is that fair? Is that fair? Okay, we'll try. Got it. Okay, that's heads. That's it.
Democrats first.
Yeah, Democrats first. Yeah.
Well, it's a pleasure to be here this evening. It's been an exciting election, interesting for all of us, and those of us who are American often get asked to explain it, that's been a challenge this year. But let me go ahead and just do what I was asked to do this evening, and that is get into a little bit about where Hillary Clinton comes from, what her platform is, a little bit of background. So it's a pleasure to join you here at the American College in Moss this evening. My name is Brad Larson, and as you've heard, I am Vice Chairman of Democrats Abroad in Norway. Tonight I'm here to make a case for Hillary Clinton as the next President of the United States. But before I begin, I'd like to make a comment on Wednesday evening's third and last presidential debate. Donald Trump had one main task in Las Vegas, as many people saw it, and that was to assure wavering voters who distrust Hillary that he is fit to be president. After speculating for days that the general election will be, quote, rigged, unquote, Trump was asked point blank whether he would respect the tradition that losers concede to winners so that the country can come together. His reply, quote, I'll tell you at the time. I'll keep you in suspense, okay? End quote. This contempt for the democratic process dominated yesterday's headlines and caused Republican leaders fresh agonies, and it should concern all Americans. Okay, that's my partisan bit. Now I get over to a semi-partisan bit with where does Hillary stand? Okay, there have been a lot of accusations and paranoia in this election so far, but maybe it's okay if we stop for a moment and just acknowledge Clinton's enormous accomplishments. In the entire history of our nation, only 6 presidents have also served as Secretary of State. Only 3 have served as both Secretary of State and in Congress. By any objective measure, Hillary Clinton is not just the most qualified candidate this season, she's one of the most qualified people we've ever had to seek the office, I would maintain. The New York Times, in endorsing her, stated that voters have the chance to choose one of the most broadly and deeply qualified presidential candidates in history. But there's another choice in this election, and it's the choice between 2 visions of America. One is a vision of a fearful America that is less secure and under domestic assault from terrorists and immigrants, and one that is left at the mercy of foreign foes by corrupt elites. The other vision, and the more accurate one, I believe, is of a strong, confident America that leads the world to keep our country safe and our economy growing. This is a vision of diversity and tolerance where citizens acknowledge lingering social, racial, and economic ills as the best method of trying to cure them. Hillary Clinton has experience with the tough calls and hard work of protecting American security and prosperity. And with all the threats America faces, we need a president who is ready to be commander-in-chief on day one. That's Hillary Clinton. She knows what's at stake and has the experience to take on our enemies and work with our friends. She's the one who left the fight for crippling sanctions on Iran, led the fight for crippling sanctions on Iran, that forced them to table and helped stop them from getting nuclear weapons. So, what does she propose? Her platform is based on what I call the democratic vision of change for our country. The democratic vision of change for the United States is not a narrow, cramped version of an America where everybody is fending for themselves. It is a vision of a big and compassionate America where everybody who works hard has a chance to get ahead, not just those at the very top, and not just those born into wealth or privilege. A vision that says that the more Americans who succeed, the more America succeeds. So, Hillary's platform is complex, but it can be grouped, I think, into 6 major areas.
One is the continuing to rebuild the economy, including tax reform and promoting jobs and growth in environmentally and energy-friendly ways. Second, national security, which includes defense and militarism and has an impact on immigration. Three is healthcare or continuing healthcare reform. Four is education and retraining. Five is civil rights, including women's and LGBT rights, and the right to safety from firearms. And six is campaign finance reform. So I'll try to go through these quickly. Number one, continuing to build the economy. 8 years ago, when President Obama took office, we were losing 800,000 jobs a month. The unemployment was on its way to reaching 10%. Today, we've added private sector jobs for 75 straight months, and the employment rate is below 5%. So it's important to keep this big picture in mind. That being said, Secretary Clinton said throughout the campaign, we need a president with a bold vision to create good-paying jobs and get wages rising across the board. She's put forward plans to do that if elected president. She's called for the largest investment in infrastructure since Eisenhower built the interstate highway system. She's called for investments in clean energy and manufacturing that will put Americans to work. And she's called for expanding paid leave and childcare that will help millions more find it easier to join the labor force. Contrast this with her opponent, whose main plan on the economy would add more than $30 trillion to the debt over 20 years, and who has suggested that we might default on our national debt. That would threaten a global economic crisis, which would cost many, many jobs. She would also take the global lead in dealing with climate change, supporting the Paris Accords, and she has plans for getting 50% of our energy needs for clean energy solutions within 10 years. Okay, second, strengthening our national security with a fair immigration policy. Radical jihadists, like so many adversaries in our history, underestimate the strength of our national character. Americans will not cower or cave, and we will not turn on each other or turn on our principles. Secretary Clinton believes the U.S. should use air support to fight the Islamic State, and that American and other Western troops should not be fighting on the ground. Instead, she argues that regional forces, especially the Iraqis, should provide ground troops. Last year, Clinton broke with the White House, saying she would call for a no-fly zone in Syria, in addition to creating humanitarian zones. On Iraq, she supports the framework of the nuclear deal that will continue diplomacy efforts and sanctions, and some sanctions. On immigration, and this is a major difference with her opponent, Secretary Clinton has made it clear that we cannot wait any longer for comprehensive immigration reform. Any comprehensive proposal, she said, must include nothing less than a full and equal path to citizenship. She would continue her longstanding record of standing with these young people who have lived in the United States for most of their lives by defending President Obama's executive actions. She would also increase the number of Syrian immigrants given access to the U.S. from 10,000 now under Obama to 55,000. They would be thoroughly vetted for up to 12 months before they are allowed entry. Number three, improving health care reform. The Affordable Care Act has been a critically important step toward the goal of universal health care, offering coverage to 20 million more Americans. Today, over 90% of all Americans have health insurance. This is one of the major things that you note when you start comparing Norway to the U.S. is the lack of health insurance or health support earlier. President Clinton would give the government a role in setting insurance rates. She would expand Obamacare, but would not attempt to create a universal health care single-payer system now. She also proposes a $250 monthly cap on out-of-pocket drug costs and a tax credit for families with huge out-of-pocket medical costs. And she also proposes the government would be able to block excessive health insurance cost hikes. Number four, education and training. In this area, President Clinton proposes a new college compact that would make community college fees and allow students to attend public four-year colleges debt-free. This would include a tax credit of up to $2,500 per student, and she would pay for the plan by closing tax loopholes for the wealthy. She also proposes universal preschool access for all four-year-olds. Access to college and retraining is an essential part of plans to help the country adjust to global changes in technology and trade. Number five, civil rights. America's made great strides in expanding opportunities for women and securing fundamental rights, but Secretary Clinton feels the fight is far from over. She is a staunch supporter of legal access to abortions, As a Secretary of State, she told a congressional hearing that, quote, family planning is an important part of a woman's health, and reproductive health includes access to abortion. She is working to close the pay gap and is fighting for paid family leave and affordable child care. She also supports gay marriage. And when it comes to the right of safety, Clinton believes it's time to act on gun violence. She knows that gun ownership is part of the fabric of many law-abiding communities, but says that we can no longer allow guns to fall into the hands of domestic abusers, violent criminals, and the seriously mentally ill. So, sixth and last, campaign finance reform. President Clinton will move to curb the outsized influence of big money in American politics, bringing light to secret spending. In order to overturn the Supreme Court Citizens United decision that was made in 2010, she would appoint Supreme Court justices who value the right to vote over the right of billionaires to buy elections. She would also push for federal legislation to require effective public disclosure of political spending. So, the choice. What is the choice? As for myself, I have been watching presidential elections since Nixon, and never in my life has there been an easier or more obvious choice than now. Trump is not merely a bad choice. He is, as many leading Republicans have already admitted, a catastrophic choice, unfit in every possible way for the office of the presidency. As such, I happily voted for Hillary in my primary, and I will proudly vote for her in November. She will safeguard us from the damage of a right-wing Supreme Court swing, which would inflict on the nation. She would stand for the rights of women, LGBT Americans, and minorities. She would maintain critical global relationships, very important, and important to Norway. And she will react to dangerous situations with the temperament of a seasoned and experienced professional. And in a nation that didn't even allow women to vote until 1920, she will make history by shattering the very highest class ceiling, and in doing so, forever change the way a generation of young women knew their place in our republic. So that's the background from Democrats Abroad, and I do look forward to questions and debates, because as you note, I had a couple of zaps to our friend Mr. Trump. But I'd love to have a lot more. Rick, your turn.
Where to start from there? Thank you. Well, sorry. Skip the slides. Thanks for coming here, folks. It's a pleasure to be here. I have to say a couple of quick things as I start here. I'm originally from Virginia, and Virginia Beach, for that matter, which is the sister city of Moss, I might say. So I've spent 15 years in Virginia Beach before I moved to Norway, and I spent many a time looking at the Norwegian lady on the oceanfront in Virginia Beach, and had the opportunity when I moved here to see the Norwegian lady looking back towards Virginia Beach from here. It was kind of a unique experience. Thank you. I worked for an NGO, a nonprofit, more accurately, before I came over to Norway, and used to run around the state legislature in Richmond, and just an interesting sidebar. And I was meeting with some legislators and. Staunch Democrat, Speaker of the House, Speaker Tom Moss, who's one of these big guys, and you know, had the respect, and he'd been there for years. And I didn't know anything about anything. And he said to me, he says, son, you got to remember that a Democrat in Virginia is like a Republican in any other part of the country. So you keep that straight, and you'll do okay in Virginia. So I think what he's trying to tell me is that, you know, this polarization and those kinds of things tend to get possibly overblown a little bit in the heat of the moment and the politics of what's going on. A very interesting election. I'm here representing Republicans Abroad, and Donald Trump is our candidate. I want to spend just a minute just saying what I feel that. What's important, one of the important aspects is why Donald Trump is there. When I was giving a talk the other day and I put up the the nominees, so the Democrat nominees and the Republican nominees again. You know, 12 Republican nominees, and I can't remember, 5 or 6 Democrat nominees. And if you looked at those pictures, you would say the two most unlikely candidates, that Hillary Clinton aside, were the potential, well, Donald Trump became the nominee for the Republican Party, and Bernie Sanders were the most unlikely of the crowd of Democrat nominees, really almost became the Democrat nominee. Some things he was robbed of that due to some manipulation of stuff, but that's another debate. So what that is saying is the American public really wanted some change and really was looking for people outside of the quote establishment and normal political system, and that I don't call it anger, as I'd call it, as a strength of voting character to try to change things. And I think that is what is happening in the U.S., and that is why Donald Trump was the beneficiary and the nominee in the Republican Party because of that. And I say Bernie Sanders was an illustration on the Democrat side. And Hillary Clinton became the nominee, and Donald Trump became the Republican nominee, and that's where we are today. And I think the repercussions and the reverberations from that particular aspect is going to go on long past the election, no matter which candidate wins. And keep in mind also that an important part is that it should be after the next election too, regardless of whether Donald Trump wins or Hillary Clinton wins, the Republican Party is controlling the Senate, the Congress, the decision-maker body in the U.S., and the Republicans control most of the states across the country as far as governors and stuff. So this, these issues are going to be ongoing after the election. So we can talk about Trump and specifics and things that he says or didn't say, and what's been portrayed in the media. But I want to take a quick opportunity to say a little bit about the policy and Republican policy and some Trump policy, because we have not heard so much policy that we've heard everything else but policy in this entire election cycle. And I think Democrats and Republicans are kind of not so happy about that aspect of things. The first thing I say, and Donald Trump has talked about this fairly extensively. If you listen carefully and bleed out the white noise of what's going on, economic growth. He is he's a business guy, and one thing that he legitimately can say that he understands fairly well the business world, and he has his ideas, and his ideas are closely aligned with traditional Republican thought as well, which is economic growth is vital to the country, and the government alone cannot be the be-all, end-all of doing that. So basically advocating for smart, simple, effective policies and regulation reform is important. Overregulation seems to be rampant and has been rampant, and a lot of folks are feeling frustrated personally and from a business aspect. So, and there also must be a fair playing field for all citizens and families to pursue a safe and healthy environment, raise kids, build communities. The Republican Party and Donald Trump doesn't accept this notion of a slow growth U.S. economy. We keep hearing the slow growth, the new normal, all these buzzwords, which means policies aren't working, and this is unacceptable. And the U.S. economy, you hear that it's not doing so bad, and et cetera, et cetera. But the U.S. economy is sluggish and struggling, just like The European economy has been sluggish and struggling for slightly different reasons at different times, but the fact is that the US economy is not doing as well as it's being sold. And or otherwise you would say, hey, you know, what's been going on for the last year, 8 years, if it hasn't been doing so good? And that is one of the reasons that Donald Trump is there and the Republican Party is advocating for change. And so this new normal, unacceptable. You know, access to capital, regulatory reform, just these things, you know, need to continue to be pushed forward and done. And there really has been limited to no progress on a lot of these issues to the state. The United States can do much better. Tax reform, that's been another cornerstone of Donald Trump and an ongoing one for the Republican Party. The U.S. tax reform is cumbersome. Here's a good quote here, and an object of both anger and frustration. Its complexity is only exceeded by its length, and which means it is a mess, has been a mess, and you know, granted, it's a very difficult thing to tackle, and getting Democrats and Republicans on board to do the right thing and move it forward has been very difficult, but that hasn't been done over the last 8 years, and little to no progress at all in getting it done has been has taken place. So that's something that Trump and the Republican Party says, hey, the time is now to do that. International trade, there's been some Trumpisms and some thoughts that he has had on this. I think when you cut through it all, and the important thing to take away from that is that free trade and open markets are essential to the United States and to the global economy. Donald Trump and the Republican Party believes in fair trade and trade agreements that benefit all parties. Trump has made some points to say that some of these policies, some of these agreements are not quite fair to the United States and its interests. And what I'm saying is that his statements are that these things need to be beneficial to both parties fairly, equally, and he's saying that some of these might not be and should be looked at and possibly you know, tweaked a bit if they can be. But certainly anything done in the future needs to be looked at from a fairness aspect when you know when they're proposed and dealt with. Another issue is America's natural resources, oil and gas development, natural resource development. The U.S. Energy industry powers our economy, creates millions of jobs, and this has been especially during the last 8 years, overregulated, and some undue interference taking place in this industry, and it's interfering with the market and the development. Not a good thing for the U.S. Energy industry. Although I have to say that the U.S. energy market has persevered. Even with a bit much regulation, and you've seen an explosion in fracking and natural gas exploration. Now, in addition with that, of course, this needs to be done in an environmentally friendly and positive way. And I think Norway is a great example of how you can merge the environmental issues with exploration and development of natural resources. Norway has done that very well, and I think the U.S. can continue to learn a lot from that. Climate change, which is always a hot button issue. The only thing I'm going to say about that is there hasn't been much discussion of that in this election cycle, and the Republican and Trump policy on that is that that any decisions made on this front need to be really looked at from a dispassionate, hard analysis of the facts and hard data. the platform belief is that a lot of work still needs to be done in this area, and research. The Republicans and Trump support the continued research in this way and climate issues and this debate, but do not support the political policy decisions that are made based on biased information or incomplete information or just sort of loose facts. You know, there's an ongoing debate of, you know, what's really happening, what's not happening, and this is still going on and needs to be debated and looked at. But you know, the pushing through of policy just needs to, it's a slow down kind of approach is where the platform and the Republicans are coming from. Immigration reform. Donald Trump has been thrown about in the media about this building the wall along the Mexican border. And I think you have to really look at this, you know, is he really talking about a literal brick wall 20 feet high? You know, nobody really thinks so, and he doesn't even really think so. What we're talking about is securing the border and having a border that works and properly contains and regulates the flow of immigration back and forth. I've been in the north of Norway, and you know, there's barbed wire fences going across the border up there between the Russian and Norwegian border, and you know, you just don't walk through there. The southern border in the U.S. has been very porous for many, many, many years. The immigration policies are not working very well, unenforced. This has caused a tremendous problem in the United States, and a lot of undocumented people are in the country. This is causing social issues. It's causing division among folks, and it has not been fixed, I'd have to say, by either party. But you know, again, the last 8 years, the Republicans have not been in the presidency, and this continues to be an important issue. And the Republican Party believes that this issue should be solved, but also protecting American families, and which includes citizens and legal immigrants. Also, the Republican Party, of course, supports the U.S. military. Peace through strength is a nice buzzword there, but strong military and a confident, determined United States is a positive benefit to not only the U.S., but the world in general. And, of course, Trump has been a bit taken to task for his alleged non-support of NATO, but he did not say that. He had said that he supports NATO. He supports NATO, but believes that maybe there is a need to relook at how in the future it can be better strengthened and do a better job. Because NATO has had some issues with dealing with the ongoing crisis. It's been taxed by demands for immigration in the Middle East. And how it works together and how it works in a positive way going forward is something that is even be talked about among the policy people of NATO. You know, how do we make this work better? So that's what he's been talking about. And also, I'd have to say a little bit from the Republican Party's standpoint. The party supports the historic ties to Europe, and most importantly here tonight, to Norway. We advocate the reaffirm and respect and determination to maintain historical friendships beyond the reach of those in the world who wish to divide us. So coming together for a better, stronger mutual relationship is in all our best interests. And I'm sure I get no disagreement my Democratic friends on that. Thank you.
Okay, so now we get to go to the fun part.
Oh yes.
I have a long list of topics here written down. We would like to have questions from the audience. The
idea originally is to have people write their questions and send them in so that we can try to maybe combine if there's a lot of questions that are repeating themselves so we can get to the topics and hit as many as possible. Are there cards that need to come up? They can go to Krista. I want to start with a question regarding candidates. How important is the candidate? How important is it, the personality of the candidate? While we're waiting for other questions to come up, that's a question I've been wondering and struggling with for a long time, and I was wondering if you guys could just address briefly, how important is that candidate? Go ahead and start.
Would you like to start with that? I think you've got the most interesting candidate.
You have a flawed candidate, Mike.
No, I wouldn't say that. I don't accept that.
I would say the candidate is important. The question, maybe another question is, for what reasons is the candidate important? And just one thing I have to say that the controversies and the image, of course, I freely admit that Donald Trump hasn't helped his cause a little bit, but at the same time, he has been, probably unduly and more than the Democratic candidate Hillary Clinton has been, as far as under assault from the U.S. media. And there's a lot of reasons for that, and I don't really want to go into it too deeply, other than to say that it is, and I think generally everybody pretty much accepts that has happened, either by his own statements or just the harsh, bloody political environment that we're in this particular election. He is, Donald Trump is a little bit under assault as the non-traditional and outside the system candidate, and he gets a little bit of assault from some deeply entrenched Republicans as well. He also gets some support from liberal Democrat side of the House as well that a normal traditional Republican hasn't gotten in the past. The candidate is important, but I'd say from the Republican side in this election cycle, and I have to say that he is not as crucial to some degree as you would find in a normal election cycle from his point of view.
Well, first I'd like to say, Rick, congratulations. I am very impressed with the job you did tonight. I'm not being sarcastic now. I really mean this because, just so you know where I'm coming from, I think the U.S. Government, I think the country is best served if we have a moderate and conservative party on one side. I would call that the Republicans, a moderate and liberal party on the left, I call that the Democrats, where we could have some discussion and find some areas of agreement so we can move forward so it's not just a gridlock. And I think that, unfortunately, the rhetoric in this campaign has not made it easy. Plus, I think you've had the extra challenge. You defended what I would call the Republican platform. But I would say that the fact that Donald Trump doesn't have support, you can define whether he's got support or where he doesn't. He's certainly not enthusiastically supported by the majority leader in the House or the Senate. They've said they've endorsed him, but they don't want him at their rallies. So there is a problem because a lot of the things he's been standing for in this campaign are not things that would be part of a normal Republican platform. I mean, if we compare it even historically. Now, times may have changed, and as you say, I think what's happened is, and I'll do this very quickly, 2008, 2009, the Great Recession, shall we say, I think most people agree to that. Huge amounts of money lost. A lot of people burned, lost houses, lost their bank accounts. They're frustrated. They're mad. A lot of people are having trouble getting jobs, and they're looking for somebody to blame. They're not pleased with Washington. They see gridlock in Washington. And they're also looking for other external factors. And I think Trump, very astutely put his finger on a couple of buttons, and one of which is global trade, which I happen to think is very important and is more important than it's found a place in this election. But unfortunately, global trade has been named the bad guy. You're losing your job because of global trade. The other thing is immigration. You have a hard time because immigrants are taking your job or because immigrants are causing crime problems. And so I think there has been this concern in the states of we're frustrated, who's causing the problem, why can't I get a job? And one of the things you said a couple of times, Rick, is in the last 8 years, and I know that, the last 8 years, Democrats have held the White House. The last 6 years, Republicans have held the Senate and the House. 2 years before that, the Democrats had the House and the Senate. So,
and the presidency.
So there are 2 years. But the point is, we can always go through this. You know, Democrats were there, nothing happened. In reality, the major problems we had with the economy came before Barack Obama came in office. So then you have a feeling of how do you deal with it? Now we can debate on whether we've dealt with it effectively or not as a country. But I think to say that when the economy is sluggish, well, yeah, compared to the 1950s, 1960s, we're 2.4% GDP. The OECD countries are 2.1%. We're slightly more than all the countries that we normally compare ourselves to. China, 7%. India, I think, is 8%. Yeah, but they started from a lower base. So we have to be careful here that we're comparing apples and apples and not apples and oranges. So that's just to say that I think Trump has managed to come in, take advantage of it very astutely. I taught rhetoric for a while at Bay, and I've been involved in speech writing in Washington. I watch how people express things, and my major concern in this election has been the use of scapegoating, the use of finding of very strong emotional language with very little content. So, and that's been a problem. That's why we've had an election that almost hasn't had content. And I don't think it's possible to blame the Democrats for that totally.
Could disagree on that.
We could.
To follow up on that question, if how things are presented is important, and a competition being so unorthodox, why isn't Hillary Clinton further ahead?
I think that one thing, if you look at, usually the way you start to analyze whether somebody's going to do well in an election is you take a look at the fundamentals. The fundamentals in this case are the Democrats have been in party for 2 terms, 8 years. Most often, when you had a party who has the White House for 2 years, the press, it's much more likely, the percentage is much higher that the other party will get it the 4 years following, and maybe the 8 years following. So that means automatically a Democrat should have more of a problem making a case this year. Also, Nate Silver with the New York Times and 538 newsletter has this model where he's talking about, that is a dynamic. The president's popularity, or job approval, now that's at 52, 53% for Obama, or between 51 and 53, depending upon how you measure it, it's been moving up. It was down at about 45 or 44. Usually it needs to get over 50 for the president to be beneficial for the party in power. So that should have helped Hillary, but it's right on the edge, okay? The other thing is economic growth, and economic growth is, you can't be, you know, it, people have to perceive that things are getting better. And I think with the latest census, we've seen that median family income has increased, the GDP has increased, but I think there are a lot of people who still aren't feeling it, and that is particularly in some rural areas and in the Rust Belt. So that's not to say that things are not good enough. And so, but that's to say, I think these are some of the challenges where that meant that Hillary may have had a harder time going in. What do you think, Rick?
And that's one of the reasons why Trump is doing as well as he is because you can't dismiss the fact that Hillary Clinton has been. A part of the government and part of the leadership of the government for certainly in recent history at a very high level and part of the government for quite a long time and around the government for an extremely long time, you know, 20, 30 years going way back. So that is basically, people look at that and say, hey, you know, this person has been around a while. I can't really see where they've been that concerned or successful at doing anything in the past, and that is a tough question to overcome. And really, she can't. And Donald Trump, regardless of anything you can say, he can certainly say that he is not responsible. He has not been in a position to implement or to move things forward. He's saying, I want that chance. I think I can do a better job. He says, I know I can do a better job. And Hillary Clinton just has to say, well, you know, I just didn't quite get it done. And people see and understand that, and they've are at a point where they said, you know, I just can't buy into that yet. And that's kind of what's happened.
Yeah, when you say people see and understand that, I think people perceive that, yes. That means that the problem with some of the discussion we've had, whether it's Hillary or anyone else who's been in Washington for a while, is Newt Gingrich actually was the one who began this, but I think the Democrats were using it a bit earlier as well for the last 24 years. We've been running against Washington. Everything in Washington is broken. We need to go in and fix Washington. That's been one of the biggest vote getters. Why? Because there's been a tendency globally now to be against authority. So many authority figures are going down in the polls, no matter, you know, whether they're politicians, whether they're business people, no matter who they are, they're going down in the polls. So it's sort of like anybody who is in power has a bad perception very often. That means people from the outside can come in. The challenge is, of course, and the challenge for Trump, he's not going to get in office. I mean, he's not going to win this thing now. No way. But, and you're no, I don't think we even have to worry about that. But what is interesting is that should he get in, he's now part of Washington. And he has offended almost all the Republicans across the board. He's got no friends as Democrats. Most of the people who are on his staff are people who he's been unable to attract many people to his staff because they feel they're afraid he's going down in flames. I have this from a number of friends in Washington on both the Republican side and the Democratic side. So it means he's working from a very small base. If he were to get in, I guarantee you he would be a one-term president. Why? Because he's promised all sorts of things that he can't deliver on. And the interesting thing about the way he's run the campaign is, when we talk about a wall, and you very wisely said, Rick, that maybe he meant wall, maybe he didn't mean wall, maybe he just means a fence, or maybe he just means we have to tighten things up. The point is, because the rhetoric is so open, because there's so few details, people can read anything they want into it. That means you get in, and then you have to start being more precise. And then you're covered by all the media, and then people see you can't deliver on what you promised. And this is not just a Trump problem. This is a problem that's going to be ongoing for all the, and to be honest, it was partly Obama's problem after 2008, because he ran on change you can believe in. He created great expectations. I happen to feel he's filled many of those expectations, but then again, I'm talking as a Democrat, so you can take it for what it's worth. But the point is, there were a lot of people on the Democratic side and the left of the Democratic Party who were extremely frustrated because he didn't move things far enough, while he's, of course, critiqued on the right for moving things way too far. So it's an interesting dynamic that doesn't just have to do with Trump and Clinton.
Yeah, so one point I'll just quickly follow up on is that when Trump wins the presidency, I think it will be quite easy for the troops to rally, the Republican Party to rally. All animosity will fade away, and there'll be a coming together of the party. Now that won't be total, because part of Trump's mission is to shake things up a bit, and the appeal on both parties to a candidate like that is there. And another, just a quick election thing, this is just my opinion, I'm throwing it out there, this election cycle, you know, this is going to be who shows up at the polls. And, you know, if the Democrat side of the House, African Americans and other, aren't enthusiastic at all and don't show up, and Republicans do show up because, you know, they've got enough fire in them to show up at the polls, this is the uncertainty that's out there and could really be an election swinging issue. And we're not going to know that till election night. And there is a lot of, you know, all the experts on both sides are still, you know, they'll say one thing in front of the media, but, you know, behind the scenes, you know, there is still a, you know, we don't know. So this possibility, this election year is so different, and the emotions are running high enough that, you know, there could be some surprises come election night.
Thanks,
this audience question really tries to get to the inefficiency of Washington and who's to blame. It notes here, and I don't know if this is correct, but Obama vetoed 3 bills, yet is blamed for the stall of lawmaking. What is Congress, the Republican Congress specifically noted here, what have they passed to solve or even to address issues of, I think it says immigration, taxes, trade, border security? Rick, do you want to tackle that first? And I'm going to ask to keep answers as short as possible. I know it's hard because I want to make sure to get through these questions.
That's a tough question. I'd have to say very little. And there is some real political reasons as to why. There is some frustration on the Republican side as to why not as well. But the real world political issue, and it's not a total issue, is the fact that with, you know, a dug-in Obama at the presidency, there has been difficulty pushing things through and getting compromises, and, you know, the unwillingness to do that is not totally on the Democrat side. The Republicans are faulted for that as well, and we Republicans call them out on it consistently. But when there is hope to push things through, it seems that the Obama presidency has not been in a position to help that process or to be a party to that, and that has stopped things dead in the tracks. It's happened before, and probably will happen again, but that is probably the biggest reason, is the, because you can have Congress, a staunch, a stubborn president, or a president that you know, has his own mind as what to do, is a formidable enough issue
to cause gridlock. And that's the main reason of why that's happening.
I would say that you said gridlock because the president dug in. I didn't quite understand what that meant.
Just that whatever proposals have come his way that have been proposed or even somewhat negotiated, that his stance was so different or he wasn't willing to compromise, and maybe there was no compromise on the Congress side as well, that has caused just an impasse that has been tough to overcome and has caused this the answer to your question on why things happen.
I think that's a harder argument to make if one party has both houses of Congress and has a large enough majority to basically press through things they want. You'd see more of that if the administration was the major problem. You'd see more vetoes.
Well, the problem is that you have a position that Congress is going to come forth, and then the president says, "I don't care what you give me, I'm going to veto that from day one. Don't even bother." Then it's tough sometimes to spend the time, the energy, the political capital to push something through, and that's what I mean by it. Yeah, there have been things that have been put through and have been vetoed, and I'm talking about some general things that the Republicans just said, I'm not going to bother because he's going to veto it, so we can work 6 months and put this in front of him, and with the swipe of his pen, he will do veto it. And there's also the political reality that, you know, the Congress doesn't have the ability to overcome that veto. So that's the impasse that you have.
Yeah, but I think one thing that we shouldn't forget is there's been a number of statements from Mitch McConnell, less from Paul Ryan, but I think from Ryan as well. Mitch McConnell said there are a number of things that just, you know, if it comes up, we're just not going to pass it. We're not, for example, Supreme Court justice. We're not going to deal with that now. Almost anything that Obama sets forward gets stopped. And I think partly that also has to do with the fact that in both houses, the Republican Party has been moving further to the right. They've been pushed further to the right by the Tea Party earlier and also the religious right, which makes it harder for moderate Republicans who might be more willing to compromise. To go into a compromise with Democrats, you can get some legislation through. So I think we have to be very careful. It's a little bit complex. But the answer, to get to your question of, you know, why is it so inefficient, how efficient is the Norwegian government? Okay. 5.5 million people. Multiply that by what? 100? What's
the U.S.? 360.
365,
yeah.
300.
I think if you take a look at some states, and if you look at the U.S., it's always best, you can understand it a lot better, I think, if you look at individual states. For an election, for example, it's not one election, it's 50 individual elections that are held at the same time with different rules, different regulations. And some of those states are run pretty efficiently. Not all of them. But then the challenge is getting agreement from different segments of the country, which means different legislators, and the question there also is how responsive is a congressman to his or her district, because if they have a gerrymandered district, which means I think in this election there were probably only really about 30-40 seats that legitimately could change place because the congressmen were so, those congresswomen were so said so much support that nobody else could, not, they had no competition. So then you sort of work for your own state and you don't care too much about what happens at the federal level, which is, I think gerrymandering works negatively on both sides.
Yeah, it works on both sides, but yeah, keep in mind that I hear that argument and I tend to always backpedal when I hear this gerrymandering. And just so you folks don't, just a little explanation is that they continuous, well, every 10 years, is it? Or do they,
after every census, 10 years.
Every census, they can the politicians can redraw the districts, and whoever's in power tends to redraw to benefit. You know, so you get some crazy districts in the U.S. But lo and behold, the crazy things happened. 2008, the Democrats came in and swept the presidency, Senate, the entire Congress. I mean, basically blew the Republicans right out of the water, took seats that they never took before. So, you know, where was gerrymandering? Where was the manipulation there? It wasn't. So, okay, and so you had that, and then 2010, the census, and the Republicans took some power, but the Democrats had the House, the Senate, and the presidency. And then, lo and behold, a couple of years later, the Republicans come in and blow out some of the Democrats in 2010, 2012, they blew out a bunch of more Democrats, and 2014 blew out most of the rest. So there is a swing factor that can go pretty predominantly one way or the other, depending on the mood of the people. Now, if the mood of the people is complacent, I would say that the districts and the way they have set up can tend to favor the party in power or the candidate that happens to be sitting there. So we don't get a lot of movement of candidates traditionally. The last 8-10 years, it's been a whirlwind. I'm from Virginia Beach, and we had, which is tradition, it's a military town, and traditionally, the area I lived, the Republican, 2008, somebody had been there forever, out the door. Democrat was installed there, and to everybody's shock and amazement, and actually a pretty good guy. In Virginia, we tend to go back and forth on our party allegiance in Virginia, but he voted with the Democrats way too closely, almost to dismissing us who lived there in Virginia. And the next election cycle, as quickly as he came, he was out the door. And of course, he was rewarded with a nice, well-paying position in Washington, D.C.
I would hope so.
courtesy of the Democrats in power, and that's kind of how Washington works.
Well, that's, yeah, courtesy of whoever is in power.
That's true.
Yeah, next question.
Okay, we are very quickly running out of time, but this is hosted by the American College of Norway. We are obviously university education, and a lot of our students are concerned with the cost of education. And this is coming from one of our ACM students, and they're wondering how do each of the candidates plan to pay for college education? I think one candidate probably has a harder time trying to explain how they're going to pay. And if you want to describe what a President Trump would do to make college more affordable, but we'll start with Hillary Clinton's, who wants to lower the cost of college. And can you explain very briefly, so we can get to more questions, how she would pay for that?
Yeah, I mean, the tax issues are complex, but basically what Clinton has said is that she wants to heavily tax the top 1% of the population, so she will have no increase, she says, in middle income taxpayers, and several independent groups have concluded that in that top 1%, they will receive about a that top 1% receive a tax cut of, I have to go to my figures again, forget how much it was, but where Hillary Clinton would have a tax increase at that level. Now, the challenge with getting into tax things is it gets so complex. The challenge from Trump's side, and all and anticipate here, is that he's talked about he's going to increase a lot of jobs, and get a lot of jobs, and he's gonna cut taxes on business, and it's gonna get so many more jobs, and it's gonna be the most income ever. I mean, trickle-down economics has had a problem with credibility. So how do you see Trump handling this?
I see Trump handling it, and I have to be honest with you and say that not a lot has been put out to either parties that I've gathered with this issue, which is it's probably an oversight because it's important. But one thing that's vital in is a huge issue in the United States is the cost of college has made it very inaccessible to people. And I think both parties see reform as necessary. The students are paying the price for it. Differing views on how that reform is going to take place. I guess the one thing that's happened in the last 8 years is the consolidation of the student loan system under the more of a government aspect. I would say that the Trump and the Republicans looking for not a government solution per se, but probably more competition would be the way to go. The college system in the U.S. has had a lot of sort of funding and a lot of loan programs, which has made it very easy for universities to raise tuition rates. They raise tuition rates, and I know from where I used to live to they were supporting sports programs and football teams and all kinds of things, which are put on the student tuition in one way or another, which is increasing college costs significantly. And I think that all has to be looked at so people can just get to school and get the education and not have to mortgage their future.
But to answer the question directly, Hillary Clinton would say that college tuition should be free. And then I myself would have to see how the cost of that, it comes out with all the other costs that are there. And I have not dug in as deeply as I need to on that myself.
Bernie said it would be free, not Hillary.
Yeah. No, Hillary said, after when she got the nomination, she said she would take that in as part of the platform. And she asked him to take care of that part of the platform.
Wasn't it taxes, the way she was going to go with that? She was going to raise taxes?
Yeah.
And isn't that basically very unpopular with the American populace in general?
I think it depends upon how you state it. I think, in general, a lot of the people actually who are Trump voters now are furious with Washington, probably more than the Democratic voters, but it's anybody's guess. The point is that there are a lot of people there that as long as you are, if you are talking about giving tax credits or tax benefits to the middle class, and you are increasing taxes at the highest percent level, I think most of the surveys seem to show that that's getting more and more popular. It wasn't popular earlier, but I think after 2008, 2009, with the increasing gap between those who are richest and those who are poorest, we see that I think more and more people find it an acceptable way to go.
Well, isn't it true that she tries to step away from increased taxes, and the thing that gave Trump some traction in the last debate was the fact that he managed to a certain degree to get her to answer to that. Mm-hmm. Because taxes are very unpopular with the American people, mm-hmm. unlike the Norwegian system. Mm-hmm. And that's something that every candidate, Democrat or Republican, has to be aware of, is that Americans simply do not like taxes.
Yeah.
And that to solve some of
the
problems with taxes.
But they like the things taxes pay for.
But we don't accept tax increases.
Now, I think what the question was, how much the debt, or part of the debates, as I recall, we're talking about how much the debt would increase based on the two systems. Trump said that Hillary's would go through the ceiling. Hillary says Trump's would go through the ceiling. Independent folks, and you can figure out if you want to believe which independent one you want to choose, said that Hillary's would increase less, the debt would increase
that's,
less.
Yeah, that's where I'm going. It would decrease less. So you would be picking your poison.
Yeah. You got to keep in mind a little bit that the taxes in the U.S. aren't as low as people perceive from the outside. When you get into the U.S., you say, okay, the federal government, that's not a bad tax rate. I mean, here in Norway, it's pretty, you've got one taxing authority for the most part, which is in the U.S., you got the federal tax, you have the state tax, you've got the local tax, you've got municipal taxes and fees. I mean, you start to add all of these things up from all these different coming at you from all these different directions, the tax rate is starting to approach what you consider a high tax place like Norway. And this on top of Americans in reality having a tough time, many of them, and the ones that aren't having a tough time are a bit worried, and the ones that are doing okay are a bit wary and concerned that, hey, things could change rather quickly.
Yep.
So on top of all this, you, when you start to talk taxes, you just get blank looks, and that's why the tax situation is like that.
Yep.
We are actually at 7 o'clock. I do want to ask, this is a question for both. It's only a one-name answer. A one-name answer.
Becky Norvog.
Yes. Correct answer. Right answer. That was a good one, though. So, Republicans abroad. Bernie Sanders or Hillary Clinton? Who would you rather have had as a president?
As a president?
Yeah.
Bernie Sanders. Without even thinking twice. And I think there's probably half the Democrat Party who would say the same thing and are probably still crying.
Not half, but I estimate a third probably.
Okay, and Democrats abroad. And that was more than a one-name answer.
Yeah, but you have to clarify.
Yeah, I suppose. And I'm surprised by that answer. As a moderate Democrat that Hillary is, that you would choose Bernie Sanders. But interesting.
That'd be easier to win.
Oh, I see. It was strategic.
Harder.
Donald Trump or Ted Cruz?
There were any number of people we could have. No, I'd actually. Oh, Ron Bell. Ron Paul.
Ted Cruz or Donald Trump in the White House as your Mr. President?
One, you can still vote for it.
But you know what? I never thought I'd say this. It probably would be Ted Cruz, and I kill
that
myself.
Hurts.
Yeah, I kill myself for even saying it. The
Not
thing
like
is that I think Cruz is despicable. I dislike almost everything he stands for. He is at least predictable, I think. And I think that although he has a super oversized ego, I don't think he's got the same psychological problems that our friend Trump has. when we wake up Wednesday morning, November 9th, we'll get the results at about 3, you know, we'll begin getting them in probably 12, 1, 3 in the morning. And then when Trump announces his start of his new broadcasting system the next day, his son has already said that he feels he's going to be stepping down to take the presidency. So we're sort of, I mean, you don't talk about, the election being rigged and all this other stuff if you're not preparing for a loss. And so, but one thing you said earlier, Rick, I think is very good. It really depends on who gets out to vote, how enthusiastic they are. And one of the things that the rigged comment brings up is if his supporters feel that things are rigged, why get out to vote? You know, my vote isn't going to make a difference. But the second thing is, if Trump doesn't, and I don't think he will, but he maintains that the situation is rigged, it's not just the presidential election that's rigged. It's the election of all the Congress and the Senate, because they're all elected at the same time.
Keep in mind, folks, he didn't ever say the election was rigged. He was asked would honor the results,
yeah.
And this is a flashback to the Al Gore 2000.
Wrong. I'm saying
wrong.
We've got video clips with our friend Donald saying the election is rigged. The nice thing with the way he uses rhetoric is he makes it general enough so he can usually slip in, slip out, say some stuff is humorous, some stuff is not. We've got video clips with him saying the election is rigged. You can't get away from the fact that he said that.
Only if he loses.
Then he backtracked.
Only if he loses.
From one name, this is 5 minutes. Seriously? Did you really go from one name to 5 minutes?
hopefully.
But it's your fault. You should stop me.
I know. I'm a horrible moderator. Yeah. But if we have a couple of minutes and people want to continue short conversations, that's probably okay. But we do want to say thank you. It's on behalf of the American College of Norway. We thank you both for coming down. Joining us, and we have some more community events coming up. We have our Halloween haunted house coming on the 28th and 29th. Very
something
spooky. Over the, absolutely. And then the election after that. So thank you both very much.
Yes. Thank you.
And
Bethany and Teresa, we have a little something for you too for introducing the ambassador and the candidates. So thank you so much for your participation tonight.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Nick, do you want to keep your tips?